حطمت أحلامهم انزلت أركانهم حطمت أحلامهم ثار الشباب لربهم حتى مضوا ثار الشباب.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله، أما بعد. Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said, and this has been reported in the Musnad of Imam Ahmed, on the authority of Abu Huraira sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said, whoever lives in the desert, he becomes coarse, becomes rough and hardened, and whoever comes close to the rulers becomes further away from Allah azza wa jal. Now this narration is in fact very famous and has similar wording in fact when narrated by Abdullah ibn Abbas, where sallallahu alaihi wasallam again said the same thing. He said that the one who lives in the desert becomes rough, and whoever comes close to the ruler falls into fitna. So you can appreciate and understand in fact, if Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam was warning against the one who comes close to the Muslim ruler, for greater qiyas, by greater analogy, we can appreciate and understand, what about then the one who comes close to the ruler who is not a Muslim? And I'm not talking about murtad, but the one who is kafir asli. The one who is kafir asli, meaning the one who rules by man-made law or rules by what is known today as democratic system, democratic way of life. What then is to be said about the one who comes close to Western governments and becomes like an agent for him on his own behalf to introduce this reformation of Islam, this new version of British Islam or American Islam or Western Islam, and starts to propagate to the masses and starts to dress up the batil as the haq, meaning a form of zandaka that somebody is committing. If we look to the statement of Imam Ahmed bin Hanbal, where he gave this nasiha, this advice to Sa'id bin Yaqub, he said, worldly pleasures, they are a disease. And everybody, they can appreciate that. The matters of the dunya, they are a disease. And he said, power is a disease. But the scholar himself, the alim himself, he's like a doctor. Meaning here we can appreciate and understand, the dunya itself is a fitan. To refrain from the dunya is something noteworthy and something for us to be acknowledged. And the doctor himself is the alim. The alim is the one who will be able to provide a solution. The alim is the one who we can refer to. Al-ulama warathatul anbiya. The ulama, they are the inheritors of the anbiya. So we should refer to the ulama. We should refer to the scholars. Ahl sunnah, ahl haq, ahl tawheed. In order to understand the truth. But he said, if that doctor, if this physician, if you will, if he brings upon himself some form of disease, then you need to be aware of him. Meaning for greater reason now, if the person who's you're trying to go to for the cure, for the solution, is himself subject to this fitan, as we understand, by going to the gates of the doors of the ruler, then what about then for us? How is it possible that he can help us? And more than that, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said, the thing that I fear for my ummah the most, more than the appearance of the Dajjal, which is a great fitna and a great test, it is the ulama asu, the misguided scholars. Those people who regurgitate the Quran and recite the verses of the Quran, those people are hafid of Quran. And did not Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam in fact say that most of the munafiqeen are those people who are the qaris, those people who are the reciters of the Quran, those people who have the great tajweed. And in fact, description being given of the Khawarij, in fact, of having the good tajweed and knowing all of the Arabic and knowing all of the being Ahl Lugha and knowing all of the Quran, but it does not go even past their own throats. Does not even go past their own throats, and they would leave the deen the way the arrow it leaves the own bow. How? Because of their extremity, and this form of extremism that we find today is manifested in this form of what we can call secular fundamentalism. Secular fundamentalism is like an extreme way of understanding this deviation and this separation between society and between our own governance and between God's laws, between Allah's governance on earth. This separation between the two is what's being pushed today and what's being cultivated today. And anyone who then wants to further the cause of Allah's governance on earth, then he's going to be regarded as an extremist. Even Tony Blair, he came out and he said, those people who believe in the concept of Khilafah, Al-Khilafah, or the Sharia, or the Hakamiyah of Allah, then they are what? They are extremist. They are the violent extremists. And now this definition being given, in fact, by even some British MPs within the parliament in their own discussion. giving definition of what is an extremist. And they said there are two types of extremists. There is the violent extremist, and then there is the non-violent extremist. What's the difference between the two? They say one is violent and one is non-violent, but they are both extremists. One believes in the concept of Khilafah and he's willing to fight for it. The other one, he believes in the concept of Khilafah, but he's not willing to fight for it. Meaning, they are both still extremists. Reminds us of the verse inside the Quran where we contextualize and look at everything and step back and look at the whole broader picture of what's exactly going on today. It is وَلَنْ تَرِدَ عَنْكَ يَهُودُ وَلَنَّسَارَ حَتَّى تَتَّبِعَ مِلَّتَهُمْ. The Jews and the Christians will never be pleased with you until you leave your own deen, until you leave your own way of life. يُرِدُونَ أَنْ يُطْفِئُوا نُورَ اللَّهِ بِأَفْوَاهِهِمْ وَيَبَأَ اللَّهُ إِلَّا أَنْ يَتِيمَ نُورَهُ وَلَوْ كَرِهَ الْكَافِرُونَ. Allah Azza wa Jalla said the disbelievers, they wish to wipe out the nur of Islam. They wish to wipe this out. But Allah Azza wa Jalla, he would never allow this to happen. So the apparent problems that we can witness, they are in fact a great fitna and a great trial for us. Much more greater than the problems from the outside. The problems from the outside, they're easy for us to handle. They're easy for us to swallow. Why? Because they're the apparent clear problems. From the outside of the house of Islam, outside of Darul Islam, you can see how the enemies, how they plot. How the enemies of Allah, His Rasul and the Ummah, how they've been apparently been described within the Quran about their wishes or what they want for you. How they wish for you to leave the deen. How they wish to harm you. How they wish for you to have this ghafla of your arms and your own baggage. Allah described in the Quran that they wish that you have this negligence of your own arms and your own baggage, so they can attack you in one single rush. Meaning, so once you start to become weak, reminds us of the hadith again, very famously, how Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said nations would gather around you like one being invited to a meal, and all of them would argue amongst themselves. They would dispute amongst themselves. I'll take this part, you take that part. Is that not what happened more than 100 years ago with the destruction of the Uthmani Khilafah? The Western nations, the League of Nations, the Christian nations coming together from Europe and Eastern Europe and deciding who's going to take what. One part is going to take Algeria, one part is going to take North Africa, one part is going to take Al-Hind, one part is going to take Philistine and give it away to the Jews, to the so-called Israelis. All of this you can find happening. That is the apparent problem. That apparent problem is very easy for us to identify. Why? Because it's something clear and something which Allah has told us within the Quran. But those problems from within, even though they are from within, they are so easy for us to identify if we open up the book of Allah and the sunnah of the Messenger Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam and his own example, and even in fact look to the seerah of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, how the sahaba, how they used to deal with, and how the Prophet used to deal with and admonish those people who were the munafiqeen, those people who used to proclaim their Islam but used to conceal their own nifaq. Those are the ones who are the problems from within. So the apparent problem is easy for us to identify, but the problem from within is when, for example, someone, he takes like a chisel or a hammer or a screwdriver or some type of tool or whatever, and he's chipping away at the glass of the house or the door of the house. Eventually, that's going to affect all of us. If it's the door or the window, eventually it will shatter. It will allow the enemy to enter directly. Not only that, the cracks within there, that shrapnel of the glass, it will affect us when it's, you know, maybe comes back and hits us in our own face. And it will harm everybody, whether it be young, whether it be rich, whether it be poor, whether it be strong, whether it be weak. And those people who are weak will be affected by this. Why? Because this glass on the apparent, or this cloak on the apparent, was on the outside of it, in its appearance, looked like it was the cloak of Islam. Some alim, some scholar, some sheikh, some from amongst the shayukh. But in fact, there were the ulama al-su, the misguided evil scholars. They were the ones who were chipping away from within. On behalf of who? On behalf of their paymasters. As the Arab saying it goes, the one who pays is the one who controls. So this is the fitna that we can find. In light of this, if we look to the present day, what is known as the war on terror, or the war against Islam, and there's no ambiguity about that. It's quite transparent and quite clear what that is all about. That is the war against Islam and the Muslims. That has to be fulfilled by the West via certain policies that they will put forth. Those policies themselves cannot be fulfilled unless there's certain measures that they can undertake. There's certain pointers or certain matters which need to be taken into hand and exercised and executed in order for those policies to be exercised. And there's many of them, but at the top of them, we can say the media propaganda tool. And this is very, very important and very significant for our own reality, because this is what really affects us as a Muslim Ummah today, heavily today. The media propaganda tool is used as a whip to try and create this frenzy amongst the community and then subdue us via the power of fear And the power of fear is when someone then becomes submissive to the desires and the wishes of the master, of the so-called master, of the oppressor, of the dalim. The power of fear is done via what? Media propaganda of creating this Islamophobia, creating this anxiety amongst the people, saying that there's some so-called threat. And then obviously then now the government then need to introduce policies and draft measures and security, security measures, emergency powers as a consequence of that. And the reality of that is what? Muslims being arrested, Muslims being targeted, Muslims being targeted at airports, at seaports, Muslims having their passports removed from them, revoked from them, Muslims having their own children taken away from them. All of this is taking place. All of this is taking place under the blanket disguise of war on terror, or war against radicalization, war against extremism, violent extremism, without any of those people who claim to be putting forth those policies and drafting up these measures and putting forth these labels, without even themselves to be able to define what those terms they mean. I mean, who defines what is a terrorist? Who defines what is an extremist? How can it be only one side is able to define those terms and another side he's not allowed to define those terms? So where is the political discourse happening? Where is the engagement between the communities? There is none really happening. There is none really happening. It is just one-sided oppression taking place. One-sided, a lopsided law, which is, as Allah has described, if the kuffar, if they have authority over you, they'll leave no sanctity. So this is what's taking place. This power of fear is then used to control the Muslim Ummah. How? Because when these raids and these sort of things happen, then that's when the Ummah starts to become subdued. That's when the Ummah itself, it starts to have this fear factor. This fear factor of being fearful of speaking out. Being fear, having this fear of not standing up for the haq. And not, and when Ja'far, when he said, he described radiyallahu ta'ala anhu, he said, when we gave the bayah to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, we pledged that we will speak the truth wherever we are. So speaking the truth, commanding good and forbidding evil, amr bil ma'roof wa nahy anil munkar, it is something which is an attribute of this ummah. But how can that possibly be the attribute of the ummah if in fact we have fear, al-hawf, it's not of Allah, but of mankind? So you can see how detrimental the power of fear it is. Then that then leads us on to the colonization. This is exactly what takes place, the colonization of our hearts and our minds. The battle of hearts and minds nowadays is one of colonizing the heart and the mind of the Muslim to make sure that it always looks up to the West. It doesn't look at anything through the Islamic shades. It looks at everything through the non-Islamic shades, through what the West it wants, what the British government they want, what the Western governments what they want. That colonization is done via this proxy of agents imposed upon us. Not just talking about the rulers, but in regards to the scholars who become the security apparatus for those rulers. I'm talking about just in the East. What then can be said within the West is then to try and create this stability between the two fronts, between the military fronts in which the West they're fighting and between the ideological fronts, and the two can never ever be separated. The two, they must be understood that that's exactly what is going on today. There is two fronts being fought. There's the military side, the physical onslaught against the Muslim lands, as well as the ideological onslaught. And that is, my dear brothers, this controlling of the hearts and the minds. How? By having this authority over us. This using this authority over us, meaning the ulama, to try and suppress our own anger and frustration. And anger for the sake of Allah. As Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, don't get angry, don't get angry, don't get angry, except for the sake of Allah. So anger can be used for the sake of Allah, and anger can be used in a negative way as well. But anger for the sake of Allah is something which is good, so long as there's no any injustice committed. So even we have this bara from the kuffar, still it does not mean that we're allowed to oppress anybody. So this authority of control is a global strategy then, my dear brothers, to control Islam and Muslims. And this is done via the munafiqeen. Done via the munafiqeen. Those policies are then fulfilled, like I said, via those various pointers, and there's much more that we could possibly mention, but by funding and promoting and cloaking what we can call and describe really as the Home Office Imam today. The Home Office Imam today will be the one who will come out and say exactly what the ruler he wants to say. I'm not talking about the kafir ruler now, the apostate ruler. We're talking about the kafir asli ruler, meaning the policies of the West, what they want. Those policies, they are being enacted. How? By this funding, by this cloaking of giving titles to them and promoting them as the representatives of the Muslim community. But this goes hand in hand with a number of matters which we need to be aware of. That is, the funding, but then on the other side is the greed from those munafiqeen as well. So the desire to try and corrupt Islam and the desire for greed from both sides, from the munafiqeen and the kuffar, they become awliya of one another. And that becomes the biggest enemy from within. And in the time of crisis, when we should be referring to those ulama, instead for them to become a source of construction for us, meaning the ones who we can seek advice, well, Alim, Ya Sheikh, what is it that we're supposed to do? Imam Sahab, what are we supposed to do? Ya Mulana, Ya Mullah, well, Imam, whatever title you have, what is it that we're supposed to do? How are we supposed to feel? We should know this. We should be able to refer back to the scholars in order to advise us and tell us. In fact, they become a source of destruction. The common response then, in order to try and deflate our own anger and deflate our own emotions and to, in fact, kill off any morale and break our own moral backbone, is responses such as, what can we do? Ghufar are so powerful, you know, they have authority over us. Better to remain silent. Safety first, you know, some ajib gareeb manhaj, or even further, some people just start to say, in fact, we deserve this. This is a punishment from Allah Azza wa Jal because we never woke up for Fajr, or never we had a miswak inside our own mouth, or we left off the sunnah. Yes, it's true. In fact, we did leave off the sunnah. But what about the sunnah of what's in relation to the actual fitna that we face? So if, for example, there's something which is taking place, there must be the correct solution for that. You can't give me the solution which is for another reality. Understanding the fiqh al-waqi, the reality, understanding fiqh al-dalil, and understanding the fiqh al-hukm, they all go hand in hand in order for us to proceed, in order for us to progress and move forward. Otherwise, we're taking 10 steps backwards. We're like a crab moving side to side. We're not going to get anywhere. We're just going to get harmed time and time again. When this fear is being pushed, my dear brothers, and when we find that there's this kind of fitna, we need some type of guidance. And the best guidance is the Book of Allah. And the best example for us is the Messenger Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. But what kind of guidance can we have in the time of crisis? How is it that we're supposed to react? How is it that we are supposed to behave? What is it that we can possibly teach to the Muslim Ummah? What kind of tools that we need in the time of crisis? How can we cripple the plots of the Tawaghit? The plots of the Tawaghit, they are there to try and destroy Islam and the Muslims. They're there to try and suppress any Islamic awakening. It's an ideological war. So for us, there needs to be an ideological defense, meaning strengthening of the Muslim community, strengthening of the Muslim Ummah. How can we do so? Let's look to a couple of points that we can in fact act upon. Number one is At-Tawakkul. At-Tawakkul is this instilling trust of Allah Azza wa Jal, the trust into Allah Azza wa Jal, into the heart of the Ummah. We need to direct our own fear and guidance via our own dawah by teaching the Muslim Ummah this. What is At-Taqwa? At-Tawakkul. What is At-Tawakkul? Tawakkul is the total reliance upon Allah Azza wa Jal, believing that the action that you do, meaning having this trust in Allah Azza wa Jal, will have an outcome. You believe that Allah Azza wa Jal, He is Al-Wakil, and you, your own self, is Al-Mutawakkil, the one who places his own trust in Allah Azza wa Jal. You rely on Him for the outcome. Now, for this tawakkul, there's three conditions which we need to be aware of. The first condition being is Al-Imanu Ibtida, that you rely on Allah Azza wa Jal and you don't rely on anyone else. Now, if we teach the Muslim Ummah this, that we rely on Allah and not anybody else, because to rely on somebody else, it would be shirk billah. This kills off any idea that we need to go to United Nations, or that we need to go to an MP, or we need to go to somebody who's a non-Muslim who doesn't even know how to wash his own backside and commits shirk, associates partners with Allah Azza wa Jal. How are we going to possibly refer to him? So this kills off any idea of that. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said, tie the camel and trust in Allah Azza wa Jal. He said, do the action, meaning do the action, tie the knot in the rope of the camel, and then trust in Allah Azza wa Jal. Some people, what they say is, tie the camel and then rely on man. Again, dodgy aqeedah, this deviant idea of this tawakkul. There's no tawakkul in fact there. And some people, they say, don't tie the camel at all, just trust in Allah. So have trust in Allah that He will alleviate our own situation, but don't do anything about it. So you do what? You do as the Prophet said. He said, tie the camel, you do the action, and then you trust in Allah, and you believe in Him for the outcome. Then, wal amalu wasatan, when you're doing the action, when you're doing the da'wah, or you're commanding the good and forbidding the evil, when you're engaging, for example, in the battle of hearts and minds, is you believe that Allah Azza wa Jal, He is wakil. During that action, you believe Allah Azza wa Jal, He will help, He will respond. And then, thirdly is wat tafwidu niyatan, you totally rely on Allah Azza wa Jal for the end result. You know, all the way to the end, Allah Azza wa Jalla, he will respond. He will answer your prayer. He will answer your call. He will fulfill your action. He will accept your own action. And he will, in fact, help you in all calamity. And in fact, if we look to the Anbiya, in fact, you can see how they had this particular tawakkul. Ibrahim alayhi salam, he was the one who stood up against the idols. And as a consequence of that, he was put within the fire. And when he was put in the fire, meaning the man-made fire, the furnace which they made to try and throw him from a catapult in, reminds us in fact of the Muslims today, how they're being thrown from one catapult in one land, such as Afghanistan or Iraq, and being flown and shipped inside their own aeroplanes all the way to Guantanamo Bay, which is sort of like a furnace in fact, being, you know, put under the middle of the sun and then being tortured and ridiculed and mocked. He said, Hasbunallah wa ni'mal wakil. Hasbunallah wa ni'mal wakil. Sufficient for us is Allah Azza wa Jal. And we depend upon Allah Azza wa Jal. That is, should be our own motto, really, in fact, in our own da'wah. Whenever we face this fitna and struggle, Hasbunallah wa ni'mal wakil. Sufficient for us is Allah Azza wa Jal. We don't depend on any man. We don't depend on any king. And we don't fear any man. And we don't fear any king. And we don't fear the helpers of the agents of the tawaghit. All of the crusaders and all of their own alliance, the ones who hate Islam and the ones who want to try and destroy Islam, we don't fear them whatsoever. Jibreel alayhi salam, he came to Ibrahim alayhi salam and he said, Ya Ibrahim, O Ibrahim, shall I make the fire cool for you? Shall I help you? He said, sufficient for me is Allah Azza wa Jalla. He didn't turn around and say, I need help from you. In fact, he refused the help. Nowadays, what people will do, if you say to them, for example, Hillary Clinton, she's going to help you. Barack Obama, he's going to help you. Yeah? They turn around and say, okay, no problem. Let me make one more phone call to her. And some people even go further nowadays. They start to write letter, in fact, for the release of our own sister, Afia Siddiqui. They say, we need to write letter to who? To Hillary Clinton, and she's going to help us. Hillary Clinton, who was the wife of Bill Clinton. Bill Clinton, the one President Pinocchio, we call him. Bill Clinton, the one who bombed Muslims inside Iraq, the one who sent his own army into Somalia, in fact. Black Hawk Down, all of this, you know, torturing of Muslims over there. How possibly someone can go to Hillary Clinton or rely on United Nations like people they do today when they go to the UN 1441 and they're going to help us inside Palestine. Palestine, they're going to help you? These are the ones who gave away Palestine to the Israelis, to the Jews. You don't know that? How possibly people, they start to become so deceived and deluded. Musa alayhi salam, he had the Shabab with him. He had the youth with him and some disabled and weak. And when he reached the sea, I remember he was chased by the Fir'aun of his own time, meaning like this Obama of our own time. And the people, they start to say, Ya Musa, behind us is what? The army of Fir'aun. What did Musa alayhi salam, he respond? He responded by saying exactly the same thing as Ibrahim alayhi salam. He said, Hasbunallah wa ni'mal wakil. Sufficient for us is Allah. We rely on Allah. We depend on Allah. And Allah Azza wa Jal, he opened up the sea. More than that, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, during his own time, there was an old man and a woman. Now, they had a son who used to help them. They used to, you know, really rely on their own son. But he was kidnapped. If you can imagine now, this type of calamity, it's one thing for someone to lose their own son or their own daughter, but another thing when you are totally reliant upon them. Not in the reliance like the way you rely on Allah, but day to day you rely on them, for example, to get your shopping for you, your food, you know, they clean the house or whatever it is, they help you in some way or another. And sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said to the man, say, la hawla wa la quwwata illa billah. There is no might or power except that of Allah Azza wa Jalla. What did the man respond? The man never turned around and said, what do you mean? La hawla wa la quwwata illa billah. Yeah, we understand that. Now what do we do now? Nothing. Rasulullah said, just say, la hawla wa la quwwata illa billah. The man, he went home and he informed his wife. His wife said, what did Rasulullah say? You told him that what difficult we got. Imagine somebody goes to the Khalif now and he says, look, my son's being kidnapped. What are you going to do about it? He said, just say, la hawla wa la quwwata illa billah. The man will say, what kind of Khalif are you? He'll be totally against him. He'll be totally opposing him. My son is lost and now you're going to tell me, la hawla wa la quwwata illa billah. What kind of sheikh are you? What kind of Khalif are you? So the woman, she never complained. The man and the woman, the husband and the wife, they both said, la hawla wa la quwwata illa billah. In fact, what happened was the son himself, the people who had kidnapped him, the son, he managed to release himself. And when he released himself, He didn't just release himself. In fact, he managed to go and find the captors' money, whatever ganima or so-called booty that these captors, these kidnappers, they've been taking maybe from other people as well. He managed to take all of that money and came back home. And when he came back home to his mother and his father, the old man and the old woman, they said, "We never seen so much wealth. We never seen so much money before in our own life." Allah's word, he revealed a verse, "We will provide from you from sources you could never imagine." If someone reads this verse today, they'll think, "Oh, Allah provides us sources from where we could possibly never ever imagine. Maybe it's the kafir is going to provide us. Maybe he's going to come and deliver us some money, some food, or whatever." But could they possibly imagine that this was revealed in regards to the circumstance of revelation? The asbab and nuzul of this was regarding one boy who was kidnapped. He freed his own self. Nobody else freed him. He freed himself with the permission of Allah Azza wa Jal. And then he managed to get the money from his own captors and from his own kidnappers and bring that money back to his own mother and his father. If you knock on somebody's house today and he's got big money and he's got big house and big Lamborghini and everything, and you ask him, how did you earn this? How did you get all of this money? Me, I was working as an MP. A'udhu billah. Or the other one, he says, "I was working in the bank dealing with riba." A'udhu billah. Ataqillah. What kind of money is this? Another one, he says, "I worked very, very hard for this. I was working, you know, maybe I was... trading in food or something like that, trading in something, you know, some type of halal business." You say, "Mashallah." But if you go to somebody's house and you say to him, "Where you get all of this money from?" And he said, "Well, what it was, my son, he got kidnapped and he managed to free himself and managed to take all of the money from the captor," meaning Barack Obama, "he managed to take all of Obama's wealth and he managed to come home with it." You'll say, "Subhanallah, what kind of muwahid are you? What kind of Muslim are you? You never heard any story like this." Sadly, we don't hear these kind of stories today. Sulaiman alayhi salam, he was someone who was given power, in fact, to speak to the animals and the jinns. And he once asked the ant, "How much is it that you eat every year?" One ant, he said, "2 grains of rice." He put him in a jar and he put 2 grains of rice. And he came back a little while later and he found only 1 grain had been eaten, another grain, it was still there. And he said, "Why did you lie to me? You asked me how much you eat. I asked you how much you eat, and you told me 2 grains of rice. I come back and I find this 1 grain of rice still sitting there. Well, what kind of, what? Maybe you're an FBI agent. Maybe you're a Fed. Maybe you're working for MI5, SO15, CIA, whatever it is, yeah? Maybe you're working for the Gestapo or something. Why you lie to me?" And he said, "Before I used to rely on Allah's wisdom, but now I rely on you. And you are a man, you may forget. So I saved the other grain," meaning like save for a rainy day. What a lesson in fact. Just from the ant, we can appreciate how to have this tawakkul, how to have this trust in and reliance upon Allah's wujud. Another part of this tawakkul, another condition of this tawakkul is husnu dhan billah. Don't doubt Allah's wujud. Don't start to doubt him. You want to boost the morale of the Muslims at the time of fitna via this iman and via this tawakkul. So this shak which people they may have, how is it possibly we can be victorious? You want to try and kill off. A good example of that is the Battle of Badr, and many verses in fact revealed about this. But the Battle of Badr was what? Battle of Badr was when there was maybe 300 and 313 Sahaba facing more than, you know, 1,000 of the enemy, and they never had any weapons amongst them. They only had like 1 camel or 1 horse, the Sahaba, which I believe it belonged to Al-Mikdad. And in the end, no one really used it anyway because they felt so shy from one another over who's going to use it. I mean, if you can imagine, for example, 1 bottle of water, and I have 1 bottle of water here, but 1 bottle of water amongst 300 people, everyone's going to feel shy over who's going to use it. Everyone's going to feel shy over using this this particular camel. Yet they were victorious. So Allah, he said, in fact, thaniris, meaning that the minority will always defeat the majority. So the haq and the victory which will be established, is not going to be by the hands of the majority, rather it's going to be by the hands of the minority, with the minority upon the truth. And sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said, there will always be a portion, the portion of this dahareen, of this taifa al-mansura, of this victorious group, who will always be, you know, victorious until the end, and they will always be harsh towards the enemy. They will always teach the enemy a lesson, in fact. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam praised them, this minority group. And there's a good lesson for us in this, in chapter Ali Imran, verse 139, وَلَا تَحْنُوا وَلَا تَحْسَنُوا وَأَنْتُمْ عَلُونَ إِن كُنْتُمْ مُؤْمِنِينَ. Allah said, so do not become weak against your enemy. Don't feel down, don't feel sad. Indeed, you will be victorious if you are indeed true believers. وَلَا تَحِنُوا وَلَا تَحْسَنُوا وَأَنْتُمْ عَلَوْنَ إِن كُنْتُمْ مُؤْمِنِينَ. Don't feel down, don't feel depressed. There's nothing for you to get depressed about. What is it possible we can do for us? So long as we rely on Allah, so long as we depend on Allah, He will assist. He will send down His malaika, just like the way He sent down in Battle of Badr, and how He assisted the believers. And how many believers that you'll find victorious, in fact, today? Maybe you've been accused of a crime. Maybe you find some difficulty in your own personal life. And how Allah, He alleviates that situation. He turns that bad situation into something good. And it may be something which you think is bad for you, but in fact, it's good for you. And there's something which you may think is good for you, but in fact, it's bad for you. Allah, He knows, and you know not. So this is, in fact, lesson for us, always to go back to the Quran, always to go back to the Kitab and the Sunnah, and look to how we should trust in Allah. So if we look to the ayat inside the Quran, which talk about At-Tawakkul, and we see the example of the Sahaba, you will find how many ayat they were revealed in regards to having this trust, having this reliance on Allah. In chapter Al Imran, verse 139, Allah, He said, وَلَا تَحِنُوا وَلَا تَحْسَنُوا وَأَنْتُمْ عَلَوْنَ إِن كُنْتُمْ مُؤْمِنِينَ. Do not become weak against your enemy. Don't feel down, don't feel depressed, don't be sad. Indeed, you will be victorious if you are the believers. If you are somebody who has Iman and you have this trust and reliance upon Allah, then Allah, He will help you. He will make you victorious. So there's nothing ever for us to feel down about. More than that, Allah, He said, إِنْ يَنْصَرْكُمُ اللَّهِ. If Allah, He helps you, no one, He can overcome you. And if He forsakes you, فَمَنْ ذَا الَّذِي يُنْصُرْكُمْ مِنْ بَعْدِهِ وَعَلَىٰ عَلَيْهِ فَلْيَتَوَكَّلْ الْمُؤْمِنُونَ. Allah, He said, and if He forsakes you, who is there after Him that can help you? And in Allah, let the believers, let them put their own trust. In chapter Ali Imran, verse 160. So there's nothing for us to ever feel down and depressed about. More than that, Allah said, الَّذِينَ قَالَ لَهُمْ النَّاسُ النَّاسُ كَجَمَهُ لَكُمْ فَكْشَوْكُمْ فَزَادَهُمْ إِيمَانًا وَقَالُوا حَسْبَنَ اللَّهُ وَنِعْمَ الْوَكِيلُ. Allah, He described about the munafiqeen. He said, those believers unto whom the munafiqeen, when they start to have this whispering and they try to make this own tasweef, in fact, they said, verily the people they gathered against you, so fear them. Allah said, but He only increased them in faith. And they said, sufficient for us is Allah, and He is the best disposer of our own affairs. Hasbunallah wa ni'mal wakeel. So here we can appreciate in this ayah, a lesson in fact, how the munafiqeen will always have this kind of speech. The munafiqeen will always say, fear them. Look at you, you got nothing. Look to them, they're so big, they're so bad, they've got everything. But in fact, what a lesson in fact inside this verse. How Allah, He described how that the believers, they were only increased in faith. And you can see, in fact, for the one who is the muwahid, when some calamity befalls him, when some hardship like this comes towards him, maybe his home is raided, maybe he's persecuted because of his own dawah, you will find his own iman will be increased. But the munafiq, he will run a mile before any test even come. Like people, they say today, us today, because of you, these laws are going to come in. What because of us? What are you talking about? And how does this law affect you anyway? You've never been targeted by the kuffar. And they ask themselves, in fact, they said, why are the kuffar trying to label us now? Why are the kuffar trying to ban us? We're such good law-abiding Muslims, and we always uphold the British values and promote their own values by promoting voting and working with the police and working with the authorities and defending this Home Office Islam. You see now, so the munafiqeen will be exposed by the hands of the kuffar, and the munafiqeen, they expose themselves by their own tongue as well. How at the time of fitna, they try to dissuade you and try to persuade you to become what? Become weak. Become defeated and depleted of your own morale, of your own wala and your own bara and your own hatred towards the tawahid. And in fact, this bara from the tawahid is a part and parcel of our own iman. Loving and hating for the sake of Allah is from the branches of iman. But munafiqeen, they hate this. In another verse, the next verse, in fact, 174 of Ali Imran. So they returned with grace and bounty from Allah. No harm it touched them. And they followed the good pleasure of Allah. And Allah is the owner of great bounty. So after this difficulty, when the believers, when they placed their trust in Allah, they came back with great gains, great booty, great ganima. They were victorious. They had their held up high. Munafiqeen then, the kind of reaction they will always give to this. Allah's will then, He said, and it is only shaitan that suggests to you the fear of his own awliya. Allah's will, He said, فَلَا تَخَافُهُمْ وَخَافُونِي إِن كُنْتُمْ مُؤْمِنِينَ. So don't fear them, but fear me. If you are true believers, never start to say we're useless, it's our own fault. No, if you fear Allah's wajal and you rely on Allah's wajal, then that is a sign of your own belief. It's a sign of your own iman. So we need to prove to Allah's wajal that we're true believers. It's not a matter of just making statements from our own tongue, but rather that must be manifested via our own actions and proving to Allah's wajal that we're worthy of this victory. If you're going to have speech of a munafiq, and you're going to be have the dawah of a munafiq, of somebody complete defeated, or somebody who's complete, you know, suppressed and you know, willingly submissive to the policies of the tawahid, then Allah is never going to help you. In fact, now the other point that we can appreciate, and another point of how we can, in fact, make this dawah during a time of crisis, and you know, really cripple the plots of the tawahid, is we need to calm the people. Calm the people and give them sakina, this tranquility, by understanding the reality of the crisis. So we need to teach the ummah what motivates the tawahid. This will in fact boost the morale of the Muslim ummah. So by this, how we can do that in our own dawah is teach the ayat of al-wala wal-bara. That will expose the wishes of the kuffar and make the ummah understand, in fact, the conflict between haqq and batil. And many people, they're not aware of this. Many people, they're not aware of the struggle between truth and falsehood. It's not a matter of targeting somebody's anger or hate towards one particular individual, but it's understanding the ideology of disbelief and the ideology of belief, how they're in stark comparison with one another, and what in fact the one who's upon disbelief wishes for the one who's upon belief. So we can teach them the following matters. Number one is that the Tawhid, he wants you to become a kafir. Allah Azza wa Jalla said, "Waddu law takfaruna kama kafaru fataqtanuna sawa." They will never cease to stop fighting you until they turn you back away from your own deen, if they can. They wish for you to become kafir so that you can become equal. All of this being mentioned in numerous ayat, in particular Baqarah 217. Allah Azza wa Jalla said, and we mentioned this one previously, that they wish to see you dead. Those who disbelieve wish that if you were negligent, have this ghafla of your own arms and your own baggage, wish to attack you in a single rush. So this is what they want really for the Muslim ummah inside Balad al-Sham. So for example now, where people, they've been having this outcry of poor, of you know, complete shock. Why is it America and UN don't say nothing against Bashar al-Assad? Because Bashar al-Assad, ya Sheikh, he is an agent of the West. Is this the same thing? What Obama's been doing is been firing more drones, in fact, than the Bush administration. But Bashar al-Assad is no different from Obama and Bush. There's no difference between them. The policies are exactly the same. It's just their styles and means are a little bit more transparent. Is this a little bit more, you know, you know, gory effect, if you will, you know, minus the pun, but you know, this complete transparency on how that torture is being taken place. It's a little bit more explicit way of killing than Obama. Why? Because under Obama and Bush, you find secret CIA torture cells. Secret meaning, as long as you don't see it, shouldn't be too much of a problem for you. But under Bashar al-Assad, and what Bashar al-Assad he's been doing is being pretty clear. And then more than that, we can teach the people that the kuffar, they wish to see you in pain. Ya ayyuha alladhina amanu la taqtakidu bitanatan min dunikum la yulanakum khabala waddu ma'anittum kad badat al-bagda min afwahim wa ma tufsiduruhum akbar kad bayna lakum al-ayati in kuntum ta'kilun. Allah Azza wa Jalla, he said, they wish to harm you severely, in chapter Al-Imran verse 118. They wish to harm you severely. Rank hatred has appeared from their own mouths, but what their hearts conceal for you is far worse. And this is the beautiful thing today. Nowadays we have social media, we have access to the internet, on the world wide web. You can actually go and see inside the hearts of the ones who hate Islam and the Muslims, what exactly they want from you. Somebody, he does some type of an action which is illegal according to the West, and you know, breaks one of their laws and offends them. And you find, rather than someone to say that this person should be punished, they start to target everybody. They start to say, may all of their children die, all of their women be raped. What kind of injustice is that? How is that justice? How is that fair retribution? You know, even according to the biblical scriptures, they say an eye for an eye, a tooth for a tooth. It doesn't say that you start to exceed the bounds. And Islam, in fact, it teaches us never to exceed the bounds. That's why even in the rules of jihad, for example, not allowed for the Muslim to target the women or the children, or even the cutting down of trees, or even to target the places of worship. For example, the churches, in fact, is not allowed to do so. The Christians under the Islamic State are allowed to live, you know, allowed to do their own worship in private inside their own churches. In an Islamic State, I should say, yeah? But not like what you find is being propagated by the West, that in fact, Islam came to just subjugate people and make them into, you know, completely oppressed. In fact, Islam came to liberate the people. More than that, Allah Azza wa Jalla said and described to us how the Tawahid, how they want to try and kill Islam. Allah Azza wa Jalla said, يُرِدُونَ أَن يُطْفِهُ نُورُ اللَّهِ بِأَفْوَاهِهِمْ وَيَبَعَ اللَّهِ إِلَّا أَن يُتِيمَ نُورَهُ وَلَوْ كَرِيَ الْكَافِرُونَ. They wish to wipe out the nur of Islam with their own mouths, But Allah, He will never allow that to happen in Surah At-Tawbah. So what we can teach is that the main dispute between us and the Tawahid is the deen of Allah. It's not that that's something personal. But if we teach this to the Muslim Ummah, in fact, that is the conflict. The deen of Allah, between the deen of mankind and man-made false religions, in fact, then that will put things into context. Because the question is being raised by many people today. Why us? Why are we being targeted? What is it the Muslim Ummah has done? Maybe we haven't done enough to prove ourselves as being British. No, in fact, it is the age-old conflict between Haqq and Batil. And this didn't begin, 20 years ago, 100 years ago. This is the conflict between Adam and Shaitan. This is the conflict between Nuh alayhi salam and his own people, between Lut alayhi salam and his own qawm, between Musa and Fir'aun, and between Ibrahim and Nimrud, and Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam against Abu Lahab, Abu Jahl, and so on and so forth. This will always be the case, that there will always be a struggle between the Haqq and the Batil. Third point is that we must build the trust by offering the Islamic stance, wa'adallah. This reminding of the Ummah of Allah about the promises of Allah. In the Battle of Ahzab, which is known as Battle of Khandaq, the Battle of the Confederates. There's a surah, in fact, inside the Quran about this. There was 10,000 Confederates. 10,000 Confederates, including Banu Nadir, Banu Qurayda, teaming up with the Quraysh. They formed this alliance against the Muslims. How many were there at that time of the Muslims? Only 3,000. But who was victorious? Was the Muslims. So this is a reminder today that when the coalition and the alliance, it comes together to try and fight Islam and the Muslims, like we find inside Muslim lands, they'll never ever be victorious. They will always be defeated. Why? Because Allah's on the side of the believers, and more than that, so long as the Muslim, he holds on to his ideology and his belief, then the promise of Allah's, it will come true. In the time of the crisis, the companions, they replied, and this is in chapter 33, verse 22, and when the believers, when they saw Al-Ahzab, the Confederates, they said, this is what Allah and His Messenger has promised us, and Allah and His Messenger have spoken the truth, and it only added to their own iman and submissiveness. Meaning, they were looking forward to the hardship and the struggle and the difficulty for the sake of Allah, because it became an opportunity for them to try and prove to Allah, this is what we're about, this is our own iman, this is our own belief, this is what Allah, He promised, that if you're upon this deen, then this is what you're going to face as a trial, as a calamity. As we know, Waraka bin Nawfal, when he was the cousin of Khadija, radiyallahu ta'ala anha, and Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when Khadija took him to Waraka, he said, I wish that I can live long enough to see you, in your own dawah, and wish to see you so I can support you in your own dawah. Why? Because no man came with what you came with except that he was persecuted, harmed, and in fact he was turned out by his own people. So today, that should be the reality today. If the man is going to propagate the Haqq, then he must understand the people of Batil will in fact confront him. And more than that, Allah said in chapter At-Tawbah, verse 40, if you help him, Muhammad, sallallahu alayhi wasallam, not that it matters, for Allah did indeed help him when the disbelievers drove him out. The second of the two, meaning when Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam and Abu Bakr as-Siddiq were inside the cave, he sallallahu alayhi wasallam said to his companion Abu Bakr, do not be sad or afraid, surely Allah is with us. Allah sent down his sakina, calmness, his tranquility and peace upon them both, and strengthened them via the malaika, which you did not see, and made the word of those who disbelieved the lowermost, and the word of Allah the uppermost, meaning the highest. So this is a great example that during the time of Rasulullah, he faced what we face today as well. Obviously, he faced it much worse. But how these words of tranquility he gave to Abu Bakr as-Siddiq. If the Rasulullah would give those words, we should also give the good words to the Muslim Ummah. All of this, my dear brothers, is just a demonstration and an exercise by way of lesson of how we can conduct ourselves in the dawah with the Muslim Ummah. Because there is a lack of ulama to do this, in fact, in our own reality today. Fourth point is that we should make lots of dua kanut. Gather the Muslims, motivate them, culture them, return them back to the examples of tawakkul, and make this continuous with the dua. There's a prerequisite condition for the dua, in fact, that you believe that he will respond. Yeah, you believe he will respond. Number five is you give the correct solution. Give the correct solution for the problem. So to resist the oppression, you speak up against it, you stand firm. You don't start to say that we need to play with our own sewing machines. Rather, you need to strike the Muslims with the seeds of taqwa. Teach them about this taqwa. Give them the correct solution for every problem. Number six is that as far as any media work is concerned, or any of our own public dawah is concerned, be as arrogant as possible. That will break the back of the helpers of the Tawahid and make their own morale depleted as far as any motivation is concerned. So you want to say to them, Muslim Ummah is very good, very healthy. Muslim Ummah will not compromise their own deen. Muslim Ummah is not affected by these new measures or these new laws. In fact, we'll carry on speaking the truth. This will make the Tawahid and the Tawahud think to himself, bite his own fingertips. What is it that I can do against this man? This man, he carries on speaking the truth even though we make all of these laws and measures. So you show them no fear. You teach the Muslim Ummah never to have any fear. Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, he said, no one of you will enter paradise. Yes, with an atom's weight of paradise. However, during the time of conflict, you should be as arrogant as possible. Don't start to sit there and cry and whack yourself up like some particular Shia. Remember the ayah. Don't become weak. Don't become sad. Indeed, you will be the highest if you are believers. Next point is that the call for the struggle for Islam, or the call for the struggle in this particular time of fitna, should be general and not specific. Meaning, give general guidelines in what the Muslim Ummah needs to learn. Not specific ones. Why? Because not everybody is able to do that. So you're not going to say to somebody, you, my friend, you need to become a spokesperson on BBC, and the man, he can't talk. You know, the man, maybe he's got some difficulty. Maybe he doesn't speak the language of the people or whatever. So by general guidance is that you tell the women, for example, and the men, that we should learn Tawheed and we should teach Al-Wala wal-Bara to our own children. And also teach them that victory is not in fact just to liberate the land, but victory is when you stand firm. If the Muslims say stand firm and they don't compromise, then they'll be victorious. If all we teach the people is that we need to fight for mud, and we don't fight for mud, we don't fight for any land or country. But if you fight for mud or fight for land, and if you, kick out the occupier, then you'll be victorious. If they're not able to do that, then they'll feel themselves completely defeated. So no compromise, it means that you're victorious. So teach this. Also, with that, is that for certain people, yes, you can give certain people tasks of action. So for example, encourage the people to do da'wah, command good, forbid evil. Those people have capability for them to send food supplies to the weak, money to the needy, visit the Muslim prisoners, write to them, support the families. All of these things, there's so many that we could possibly mention. Last point is that we must focus on the status of the believers. And there's a lot more points, in fact, but we know these should be sufficient for us. Number one, in regards to this, is that we must remember that we are the children of Adam alayhi salam, who have been elevated over any tawhid. Yeah, we're above that. You know, نَحْنُ قَوْمًا عَيْزَ اللَّهِ بِالْإِسْلَامِ. Umar ibn Khattab, he said, we are people or ummah who have been dignified by Islam, and the kufr will humiliate anybody. We should always remember this. We should always remember that we are the victorious ummah, that we are the ummah of tawhid, we are the ummah of sanctity, of dignity, and of prestige. Why? Because of our own monotheism, our own belief in this monotheism of Allah's wishes. We don't ascribe partners to Him, we don't lie upon Him, we don't ascribe anything to Him which is not to Him, and we believe in His word, and we are people who are submitters to Him. And secondly, is that this victory then is the promise from Allah's wishes, and Malaika, they will help us. Allah's wishes, He said inside the Quran, تُؤْمِنُوا بِاللَّهِ وَرَسُولِهِ وَتُجَاهِدُونَ فِي سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ بِأَمْوَالِكُمْ وَأَنفُسِكُمْ ذَلِكُمْ خَيْرًا لَكُمْ إِن كُنْتُمْ تَعْلَمُونَ. Allah Azza wa Jalla said in chapter As-Saff, verse 11, those who believe in Allah and His Rasul, and they strive hard in the cause of Allah with their own wealth and their lives and their own property, that is better for you if you but knew. So whatever we have, we should donate for the sake of Allah. Whatever time we can donate or we give and commit ourselves to the da'wah for the sake of Allah Azza wa Jalla, then we should be doing so. It is an absence of people today to come out and declare the truth, of at least propagate the right ideas, of make propaganda for the deen of Islam. They can call it radicalization, but this is, call it radicalization then. Propagating the right ideas. The right ideas meaning Islam is the truth, everything else is batil, and Islam came to spread the peace on the earth. When people talk about friends of the earth, the Muslims, they're the real friends of the earth. Not this kind of rubbish that we find from them. They claim that they're the peacemakers, but in fact they're the mischief makers. Allah said that inside the Quran. So we need to be able to do that. We need to be able to also purify Islam from any negative propaganda which is being made against it, and any lies which are being attributed against it, and many lies being made against it, in fact, as well. How Islam came to subjugate the woman and oppress the woman, how there's no freedom, for the Muslim ever to even smile, and we're just miserable people. No. And in fact, all of these different things which are being attributed, that we worship, in fact, the black house. I mean, what kind of lies are these? We worship the moon god. This is all rubbish which needs defense. Ibn Taymiyyah, he said, Rahmahullah, whoever rises for the deen of Allah and acts upon it and sincerely calls upon it, he is from the true inheritors of the Anbiya and the prophets and the messengers. And those people, they are the best people. He described them as a ta'if, a tayyiba, the best people. And they will spread this goodness, this deen on the earth, the way the pure water, it spreads and it produces crops. So there is nothing other than good from good. So there can be never be anything for us to ever feel down about or depressed about, knowing in fact that if we do the good work, if we do that which is right, then what will come out of that will only be goodness, will only be something which will nurture us for something which will be a prosperous life in this life and something which is a good hereafter. And ultimately that's what we're striving for. That's what we're trying to seek. What we're seeking for is for the widening of our own grave. What we're trying to seek is a good palace inside the Jannah, forgiveness for our own sins and whatever actions and whatever sayings and whatever good deeds we can possibly do in order to alleviate ourselves from any punishment in the hereafter, and for Allah, for Him to forgive us of our own sins, then we should be striving and struggling towards that. So the da'wah in the time of crisis is in fact, it becomes an opportunity in fact, a good opportunity for you to purify your own self. If you mean somebody who's a bad Muslim or your own life, and there's nothing called a bad Muslim, but somebody who's been bad all your life and negligent of your own role and responsibility as a Muslim, then it's time for you to step up and become somebody wahid, somebody who's going to be, you know, a team player, somebody who's going to be like a true representative and ambassador for Islam, somebody who's going to make tajdeed and revival for Islam. And the Ummah of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam is desperately in need of that. Does not matter how many sins that you committed in the past, you could be fasik, fajr, you could be somebody sinful all your own life, you could be somebody you never even prayed in your own life, you know, somebody you never even fasted in your own life, but now is the time. Take the opportunity today. Don't wait till tomorrow. Those chances, they don't come every day. Allah, He's preparing us for victory by giving us these opportunities. Allah, He's using the policies of the West for this Islamic awakening. This Islamic awakening which is taking place now is a beautiful time. It's a time where the Shabab, the youth, they can wake up to their own responsibility. The elders, they can wake up from their own negligence if they possibly had it. The women, they can understand their role and responsibility as mothers, as wives, as sisters, as daughters. And the sons, they can understand their own responsibility. Every single Muslim, he has a responsibility. And I'll finish with the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, where he said, each and every one of you is on the frontiers of Islam. You're on the frontiers of Islam. So don't let Islam be attacked from your own side. Whatever capability you have to try and defend Islam and the Muslims and the deen of Haq against the deen of Batil, then do so. It is something noteworthy, it is something praiseworthy, and it is something which is a characteristic of the people who are the citizens of Jannah. And may Allah will make me and you from amongst those people who are the citizens of Jannah. Jazakallah khairun. If there's anything good I said, it's all from Allah. Any mistakes, they are all but my own. وصلى الله سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم جزاك الله خيرا